You've cut rates three times last year, the last time in October, which investors saw as sort of a green light for investment. And after your December meeting, when you basically forecast no rate moves this year at all, the S&P has been up 5% since then. Do you worry about your impact on asset prices?
Yes, I do. I do. And I think there's three aspects. There's one, rates are lower. And we lowered rates last year, and I was a supporter of those rate reductions because I was worried about weakness in the economy. Then there's a perception that the bar is higher for future rate increases. I don't know if I completely agree with that, but that's part of our communication. And then the third issue is, in order to address this repo issue, we've grown the balance sheet. Now, I think we've done what we had to do, but I'm very sensitive from here that we need to be finding ways to limit and temper the growth in the Fed balance sheet. But I'm conscious all three of those actions are contributing to elevated risk asset valuations. And I think we ought to be sensitive to that at the FOMC, and I certainly am.
Well, you say it's not QE. A lot of our guests on this program from the market say it is QE. Yeah. So is it not QE if they believe it is?
So it's, on the one hand, it's not QE because we're not buying along the curve. On the other hand, my own view is it's having some effect on risk assets. It's a derivative of QE, and that when we buy bills and we inject more liquidity, it affects all risk assets. And I'm of that view. So for me, this is why I say growth in the balance sheet is not free. There's a cost to it. And we ought to be very disciplined about it and sensitive to it. I think we've done what we've needed to do up to now, but I think it's very important that we come up with a plan and communicate a plan for winding this down and tempering balance sheet growth, and I'm very hopeful that we will do that.